Hello everyone and welcome. In this video we are talking about Mazda's revolutionary SkyActiv-X engine. It's really cool what they're doing with this and the basic approach is they're trying to, you know, determine what is the ideal engine and how do we get our internal combustion engine there. And I think the question will come up, you know, why are they spending money and time improving the internal combustion engine when the future will probably be electric? And they are looking at hybridizing their vehicles and they are looking at purely electric vehicles. They will be making them in the future. They have said that that is in their plans to do. But that said, there are still improvements which can be made to the internal combustion engine. And I think kind of the proof of Mazda's logic with this is that for the past 5 years, Mazda has had the EPA's highest corporate average fuel economy rating for all manufacturers, and that's without a single hybrid or electric vehicle. So their approach is logical. You know, they're improving something, they're making it better, and they are overall reducing CO2 emissions of the automotive world out there, and they're doing it better than pretty much everybody else without hybridizing or electrifying their cars. That's not to say that an electric car can't have better emissions, but the way Mazda is doing it is very smart for the time being. So before we get started into what are the specific changes they have made to create this ideal engine or work towards this ideal engine, how does this engine work? And so the premise of it is something called spark-controlled compression ignition. So it's operating much more similarly to a diesel engine, except that it's still using a spark plug. So what you have happening is you have an air-fuel mixture and you're going to compress that air-fuel mixture as much as you can without it igniting. You want it to be just before it's about to ignite from pressure and heat alone. And then right when it gets to that point, you fire a spark plug. That spark plug creates a pressure wave, and as that pressure wave expands outward, it forces the rest of that mixture, which is just before self-combustion, just from heat and pressure, the pressure rises just a little bit more, and then all of it simultaneously ignites. So similar to a diesel engine, which it gives you a really high temperature and pressure area, you spray in that fuel and it immediately ignites. Here, instead, you have air and fuel. You wait just before it's about to ignite, fire a spark plug, that increases the pressure just slightly, and then you have all of it combust simultaneously. So that's the methodology behind it, but you cannot always run it in this mode. So in, you know, the ideal conditions, you want to run it with spark-controlled compression ignition because the efficiency is greater, but you can't always do that. So if you're looking at a graph of load versus RPM, there is going to be, you know, kind of a faded area where it switches from spark-controlled compression ignition to a regular spark ignition engine. So it operates just like any other gasoline engine out there. Actually, it'll be running an Atkinson cycle when it's running on spark ignition, but operating like a traditional gasoline engine. The spark ignites, the flame travels through that air-fuel mixture, you have combustion occur. So there's kind of this, you know, shaded area which, where it switches between the two. The important thing to keep in mind is that it is always using a spark to control when compression occurs. It's not going to have just purely compression ignition. It's always going to be using a spark in order to properly time when that ignition occurs. So now let's get into what are the ideal, you know, what is an ideal engine and how did Mazda work towards that ideal engine? So an ideal engine has a super high compression ratio, as high as you can make it. And Mazda previously had the record in a production vehicle with a 14:1 compression ratio for a gasoline engine. And in the prototypes, which I got to drive, they are running 16:1. So this will be very close to what ends up in the production engine. Somewhere around 16:1 is where they found kind of the ideal scenario. And so this will be the highest of any gasoline engine out there. Now, what's the problem with high compression ratios? They give you more torque, they give you better efficiency, but they lead to engine knock. And engine knock destroys engines. But in this case, we actually want engine knock occurring at the right time. So it's not the same thing, but it's very similar. So basically they want to control when knock occurs, but instead of randomized knock, they want complete combustion of everything surrounding that entire air-fuel mixture at the same time. And what's cool about this is they're running a 16:1 compression ratio with 87 octane fuel. So regular octane gas, they actually found ideal was with 80 octane. But of course, you know, in the States, 87 octane is the regular fuel that's available. So that's what they're choosing to use. But a 16:1 compression ratio would never be paired with the lowest octane fuel in a different style engine. And this one, because they want knock to occur, not exactly the same thing, but they want that compression ignition to occur, a low octane fuel is desirable. Okay, so it has high compression ratio, that's one thing. Another thing you want is lean combustion. And the reason why you want lean combustion is lean combustion gives you lower flame temperatures, it gives you less nitrous oxide emissions, and it gives you less energy lost as heat. So it means it's going to operate more efficiently. A lot of people say that as you lean out an air fuel ratio, it burns hotter. That's not actually true. What happens is here we're looking at a plot of an air fuel ratio. Here would be a rich air fuel ratio. Here would be a very lean 14.7:1. That's stoichiometric, or the ideal air fuel ratio, which means all of your fuel and air is burned completely. So that's going to be essentially where your peak combustion temperature is. And it's also going to be where your peak nitrous oxide emissions are occurring. And as a result, that's not really ideal from an emission standpoint or from a combustion standpoint, because your temperatures are hot and you're producing a lot of bad emissions. So by leaning out that ratio, the combustion temperatures start to fall and your nitrous oxide emissions just completely plummet. And so there's a huge benefit if you can run it really lean. And the way they do run it lean, there are problems with lean combustion, and that is that lean burns slowly and it burns kind of incomplete. And so they have a very clever method where when that intake valve opens and the cylinder is pulling down, it creates this swirl within the cylinder. And that swirl helps to even out the ratio. And then they also have direct injection. And so they wait as that piston is coming upwards towards the top. This has an air fuel ratio of about 37:1, which is unheard of in gasoline engines. Typically, you're not going to see much higher than 16:1, something like that. Ideally, you're floating around that 15:1. So 37:1, 2.5 times the ideal ratio. So as it's coming up, there's a direct injector, and that sprays a little bit of extra fuel, which is right beside the spark plug. So the area near the spark plug is less lean than the area of the rest of the cylinder. So about 29:1 right beside the spark plug, and then 37:1 on the other areas. The reason they do that is to help for that spark-controlled ignition to occur. So the spark-controlled ignition occurs, then it starts to expand out and it forces the rest of this to combust simultaneously. So very cool what they've done. Now this is actually a supercharged engine. So there's a supercharger on it. Mazda calls it a lean supercharger. And the reason why they call it a lean supercharger is because it's not to improve performance. It can improve performance a bit, and they do use it slightly for that. But the real reason why it's on there is to control the amount of air going into the engine. They want to be able to produce these super lean conditions where you have that air fuel ratio of 37:1. And that means a ton of air needs to get packed in there. And so that's why they use the supercharger. And the benefit of running this lean combustion, as mentioned, you've got less energy lost as heat from those lower combustion temperatures. You've got less nitrous oxide emissions. And because you have extra air in there, that extra air heats up during combustion, and that basically multiplies the effect of increasing the pressure within the combustion chamber. So you're improving the efficiency without necessarily using more fuel. So it's a very clever method of getting super efficient combustion. Okay, let's move on to our third ideal scenario, which is instant combustion. Basically, with an internal combustion engine, you want that combustion to occur completely at top dead center all at once, no delay whatsoever. And so with a gasoline engine, you have a spark that fires, and then the combustion travels outward from that spark and eventually burns up everything in there. With a diesel engine, it's much more instantaneous. It's much faster. You spray in the fuel and immediately everything burns. So as you can see, in a diesel engine, you've burned up everything when the piston hasn't moved down all that much from top dead center. Versus in a gasoline engine, that piston's going to move down significantly more before all of that air and fuel has been burned. So why isn't that ideal? Well, think about it. This combustion is what's pushing your piston down. So if it combusts at the very top, that means it's going to be pushing your piston down the entire time. If it's combusting towards the bottom, that means it doesn't have much time that it's going to be pushing that piston down. So it's not doing as much useful work. So with SPCCI, it's much similar to diesel ignition. You have that spark fire, and then instantly everything else around it combusts. So it's a much quicker combustion than a gasoline engine. That improves efficiency, and that also improves torque. Very cool to have. So our final thing is combustion timing. And as mentioned, you want complete combustion to occur at top dead center, and you want that combustion to occur at top dead center. So timing is the really tricky part here, which is what, initially why they chose to use a spark plug to control the compression ignition. So what's super clever about this engine, they have a pressure sensor on the top dead center. So it's not actually a spark in the top center. The spark is a little bit offset, just like the fuel injector. And they've got a pressure sensor up top there. And that pressure sensor is monitoring the pressure inside of this combustion chamber. And so if you look at pressure here on our vertical axis, and the time, you know, basically our crank angle on our horizontal axis. So where is that piston? Right here, from here to here, it's during the compression stroke. So that's the time from the compression stroke. This is the time for the power stroke. And then right here, this green line, we have top dead center. So your spark fires during that compression stroke, and you can see that that causes the pressure to rise. So that little bubble of, you know, combustion that's occurring is going to cause the pressure inside the cylinder to rise. And you want that pressure to rise to the self-ignition temperature of the air-fuel mixture. So once it reaches that self-ignition temperature and pressure, then all of a sudden the rest of the cylinder combusts and you have a big peak in pressure. So you want that peak in pressure to occur basically immediately after top dead center so that you get all the useful work out of it. You don't want it to be delayed, you know, way after top dead center, then you're not getting as much useful work. And so the way that they control this, what happens with, if you have different humidity, different air temperature, different engine load, different RPM, things like that, there's all kinds of variables that will cause how long it takes this spark to reach the self-ignition temperature for that combustion pressure to get high enough for the rest of the compression mix to combust. And so that timing is what's super sensitive. Basically, you know, all kinds of ambient conditions are changing this. So that's what this pressure sensor is monitoring. It's saying, how long is it taking for the spark to fire and then compression ignition to occur? And if it's taking a long time, it'll advance the timing. And if it's taking a shorter amount of time, it'll push that timing back. And so that way it's always using this pressure sensor to optimize that this big peak right here in pressure is occurring right after top dead center. So you get the maximum amount of performance and efficiency out of the engine. Very cool what they're doing. All four of these really exciting kind of methods of having this approaching towards the ideal internal combustion engine. So what are their results? You know, what has all this done? Well, the SkyActiv-G engine was class leading. That's their previous gasoline internal combustion engine, was already class leading in fuel economy. And they have increased its fuel economy by 20%. And almost just as exciting, if not more exciting than that, is that it now operates efficiently at a much wider load range and a much wider RPM range. So what does that mean? Well, you can be on the gas more, and it can also use shorter gearing or more aggressive gearing so that you're at higher RPMs, and you can get that response without sacrificing fuel economy. So that's what's really cool about this engine. You can be at higher RPMs and higher engine loads than you would traditionally be at and still be more efficient. So that's it's really cool that it's going to be an engine that will have a lively characteristic. I did get to drive it, which was pretty exciting. And you know, it's not a super powerful engine. The prototype that I drove was about 190 horsepower, but you know, you can have more aggressive gearing with it and you get response out of it. So it leads for an engine that has characteristics that make it fun to drive. Sure, you could tune it for, you know, different horsepowers, but ultimately the idea behind it was to make this ultra efficient internal combustion engine, but it also doesn't sacrifice, you know, the boredom that could be associated with a highly fuel economy, highly engineered vehicle purely for fuel economy. So thank you all for watching. And if you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them below.